Hello from ChemHelp ASAP. This video describes the recently approved drug, SOTAGLIFLOZIN, sold under the brand name Inpefa. The video emphasizes the MedChem properties of the drug rather than the clinical pharmacology. If you happen to be a scientist who worked on this project and are at liberty to speak about this research or your general work at Lexicon, I would be very interested in interviewing you for a separate video. The channel email address is in the video description. The approval of SOTAGLIFLOZIN comes from New Drug Application 216-203 to the U.S. FDA. Approval was granted on the 26th of May in 2023. The active ingredient is SOTAGLIFLOZIN, which is the U.S. adopted name. The brand and name of the drug is Inpefa. SOTAGLIFLOZIN is an oral drug and is administered orally through either a 200 or 400 milligram tablet dose. SOTAGLIFLOZIN's indication is for reduction of cardiovascular events in adults with heart failure or conditions associated with heart failure, such as type 2 diabetes or chronic kidney disease. The applicant that sponsored the NDA is Lexicon Pharmaceuticals. All this information can be found through the FDA's Orange Book, the first link below, and the prescribing information of SOTAGLIFLOZIN, the second link below. SOTAGLIFLOZIN has a bit of a history before the NDA being discussed in this video. SOTAGLIFLOZIN was originally developed to treat type 1 diabetes. Its MAA in the European Union was approved in 2019. The FDA, however, denied its NDA. Furthermore, approval in the EU was withdrawn in 2022. Was a withdrawal for a safety issue or a lack of efficacy? Apparently not. Approval in the EU was withdrawn by request from SOTAGLIFLOZIN's sponsor, Guidehouse Germany, which is quite interesting, but I do not have any additional information on this matter. Let's talk about SOTAGLIFLOZIN's targets. SOTAGLIFLOZIN has two targets, SGLT1 and SGLT2. SGLT stands for sodium glucose cotransporter. SGLT1 is expressed in many tissues, including the kidneys and intestine. SGLT2 is found in many places in the body, but not the intestine. I often think of drug targets as falling into just two categories, enzymes and receptors. But here is yet another type of drug target, a transporter protein. Of these two targets, SGLT2 has received more attention in the past and is an established target for the treatment of diabetes. SGLT2 blocks glucose reabsorption in the kidneys and reduces plasma glucose levels. SOTAGLIFLOZIN inhibits both SGLT1 and SGLT2. So SOTAGLIFLOZIN presumably has an effect on glucose transport in the intestines as well as other parts of the body, such as the kidneys. There are a number of other SGLT2 inhibitors, other members of the GLIFLOZIN class. The first to be approved was dapagliflozin. Two others are on the screen, empagliflozin and canagliflozin. These compounds have clear structural similarities. In all structures, the left half is essentially glucose. This is not surprising since the compounds are binding a glucose transporter. The right half of the molecule is a relatively nonpolar region. While SOTAGLIFLOZIN is very similar in structure, SOTAGLIFLOZIN is less selective for just SGLT2. Here again is the structure of SOTAGLIFLOZIN in the upper right, along with some of the most common metrics used to measure compounds, specifically orally administered compounds. SOTAGLIFLOZIN has a molecular formula of C21H25Cl05S, not even a single nitrogen, which is uncommon for a drug. The heavy atom count, a count of all atoms except the hydrogens, is 28. The molecular weight is 425 grams per mole. The calculated log P is 2.91. The number of hydrogen bond acceptors and donors are 5 and 3, respectively. These four criteria, molecular weight, log-P and HbA-HBD are the criteria for Lipinski's rules, or the rule of five, although violations to Lipinski's rules are well known. Having a molecular weight less than 500, log-P less than 5, HbA 10 or lower, and HbD 5 or lower in a molecule is often associated with higher oral bioavailability. The structure has 6 rotatable bonds, and its topological polar surface area is 104 square angstroms. These values are also linked to membrane permeability and improved absorption. So, we know that sotagliflozin is orally dosed, and its physicochemical properties are all consistent with an oral route of administration. This slide shows sotagliflozin's potency on SGLT1 and SGLT2. Sotagliflozin is about 20-fold more selective for SGLT2 based on the IC50 values, but a 20-fold selectivity is very poor relative to the other gliflozins. These potency values can be found in the IUPHAR BPS Guide to Pharmacology site. While an IC50 value is not the same as a KI, we can still use the IC50 to estimate the binding energy of sotagliflozin for SGLT2. Based on the IC50 value, the binding energy is nearly 12 kcals per mole, which is quite strong. From this binding energy estimate, we can determine two common composite parameters discussed in drug discovery. The first is ligand efficiency. Ligand efficiency has somewhat fallen out of favor, but is still encountered sometimes. It is simply the binding energy divided by the number of heavy atoms. A value of 0.42 kcal per mole per heavy atom is high and indicates that the binding energy is quite good relative to the size of the drug. Another composite parameter is LipE, or lipophilic efficiency. It is calculated as the difference between PIC50, that is, the negative log of IC50, with the units on IC50 being molarity, not nanomolar, and log-P. LipE contrasts potency and lipophilicity, and higher values, maybe greater than 4 or so, are better. High lipophilicity is associated with all sorts of potential issues, including lower solubility, high toxicity, and being a substrate for efflux transporters. In short, sotagliflozin seems to be a well-optimized structure with excellent potency and promising properties resembling drug-like compounds. This slide shows the key PK properties of sotagliflozin. The half-life is fairly long at 20-plus hours. Both the clearance and volume of distribution are quite high. The bioavailability is around 25% according to the prescribing information, the bottom link. Drug Bank lists the value as about 70%, so there seems to be some disagreement on this parameter. Plasma protein binding is high. Renal excretion of unchanged drug is low, but over half the drug dose is cleared renally as metabolites of the parent drug. Approximately 37% of the metabolized drug is excreted in the feces. Let's now talk about the metabolism of sotagliflozin. The primary metabolite of sotagliflozin, the parent drug, is the 3-O-glucuronide, sometimes called M19, which forms by phase 2 conjugation. Nearly all the circulating sotagliflozin is present as this metabolite. M19 has negligible on-target activity. This raises an interesting question. If the main circulating metabolite is inactive, then how can the drug show in vivo efficacy? I'm not certain, but the answer may be in how the metabolite circulates. Here is a very simple cartoon that may represent how the metabolism of sotagliflozin exerts its effect. Sotagliflozin, P, the parent drug, is administered orally. It travels down the GI tract and is absorbed into the liver. In the liver, the parent drug is largely conjugated to M19. M19 enters the general circulation from the general circulation, some of M19 is cleared by the kidneys and excreted in the urine. Some M19 finds its way back to the liver. From the liver, glucuronides like M19 are often excreted as bile to the gallbladder and ultimately secreted into the GI tract. In the GI tract, M19 can suffer two fates. One, M19 can be excreted in the feces. Two, the bacteria in the gut often cleave glucuronic acid from glucuronides. When this happens to M19, the parent drug reforms and can be reabsorbed, enter the liver, and repeat the entire cycle. This process is called enterohepatic circulation and is partially responsible for the extended half-life of sotagliflozin. What does this have to do with the activity of sotagliflozin? Remember that sotagliflozin is active on both SGLT1 and SGLT2, unlike most other members of the gliflozin class, which are highly SGLT2 selective. Furthermore, SGLT1 is well expressed in the intestine. So, the extended exposure of sotagliflozin, the parent drug, within the intestines may differentiate it from the other gliflozins and explain its cardioprotective effects. There's a lot of speculation here, and the observed efficacy of sotagliflozin does not seem to be fully understood mechanistically at this time. Sotagliflozin does carry some safety risks, all of which are associated with its on-target activity. Diabetic ketoacidosis can occur when cells switch over to increased fatty acid metabolism because of reduced glycolysis. Volume depletion involves reduced intracellular fluid volume and occurs with electrolyte changes in the kidneys, an outcome of SGLT inhibition. Urinary tract infections and fungal infections can arise because of elevated glucose levels in the urine. Hypoglycemia is particularly a risk in non-diabetic sotagliflozin patients. Those are some highlights for sotagliflozin, marketed as Inpefa. Sotagliflozin is among the drugs to be recently approved by the U.S. Food and Drug Administration. Thank you for watching to the end of this drug approval summary for sotagliflozin. Please consider subscribing to the channel, leaving a like, or making a comment. Take care.